So today I'm going to share a little bit of a story with you about some of the impacts of 3D printing. But before I do that, let's back it up a little bit, and we're going to talk about what it is and why you're hearing about it so much right now. So 3D printing is also known as additive manufacturing, and it refers to a handful of technologies that use computer-controlled machines to build up an object in layers. So one example of this is a MakerBot, which is a filament-based printer. It essentially works like a very accurate computer-controlled glue gun. There's a plastic filament, gets pushed through a hot nozzle, and the printer draws layer after layer until you get a 3D printed object. Now, this isn't the only kind of 3D printer. There is also a brand called Form One, and this is a technology called stereolithography. And so it starts with a vat of liquid resin, and a laser cures very thin layers of the material, and over several hours, a object emerges. We've also got other technologies that fuse layers of powdered nylon or bind layers of gypsum powder with superglue-like adhesive. You can even find 3D printers building in sugar or chocolate or giant cement 3D printers creating structures. So the bottom line is, regardless of the material or the process, if it's built up in layers, we call it 3D printing. So we are hearing a lot about 3D printing right now, but this actually isn't a new technology, and that surprises a lot of people. Most of the patents actually originate from the 1980s. This is an original stereolithography patent from 1986. So originally, 3D printing was developed as a way of making faster prototypes, and that's one of the reasons that it's often called rapid prototyping. Whether it's a car or a phone, product designers use prototypes to test the look and feel and function of an object before they gear up for mass production. But those first 3D printers were really expensive, hundreds of thousands of dollars, and so they were really only accessible in big industries. So a few years ago, all of that started to change, partly because the patents started to expire. Hobbyists began building their own homegrown machines, early prototypes like these from the RepRap project in 2010. Evolved into a full-on industry race within only a couple of years. And now we have sort of this explosion of new low-cost desktop 3D printers. So now you'll find 3D printers all sorts of places: schools, libraries, makerspaces, studios, garages, and workshops. There's even a 3D printer on the International Space Station. So now that we know a little bit about 3D printing, what it is, machines that build up objects in layers, and why we're hearing about it so much right now, it's newly accessible to the masses. You know, that in and of itself isn't really that disruptive. But this technology has a lot of potential for impact. So this is where I want to tell a little bit about how I've been using 3D printers. For the last decade or so, I've been working in the theater industry as a set designer. I primarily work as an associate to the designer John Lee Beatty, and together we work on a mix of Broadway and regional productions. And the photos I'm showing you today here are sort of a mix of our work. So set designers create designs with tons of different documentation, plans, elevations, paint specifications, but it's often really those scale models that are the most accessible to a wide variety of collaborators on a project. So whether it's a producer approving a budget, or a carpenter on the shop floor, or an actor in a rehearsal room, everybody can look at that model and say, you know what, I know what this space looks and feels like, and I know where I fit into it. So how does 3D printing fit into all of this? I bought my first 3D printer in 2011, which is kind of early days in that DIY scene. It was a kit that I put together myself, and I started experimenting with 3D printed furniture and details. Now, the models I build today are a blend of sort of old school model building with X-Acto knives and mat board along with 3D printed parts. With a 3D printer, I can tackle more detail faster to better get across that big picture to directors, actors, and producers. Okay, so cool, right? Now, there are lots of stories like mine, people using 3D printers in interesting ways to make their lives easier. But I actually think that the way that I'm using a 3D printer is gonna be pretty mundane in a few years here. This technology has the potential for pretty big impact. So 3D printing completes a digital loop. I will be the first to admit that great set design does not require computers of any kind. But as designers today, we're really increasingly interfacing with digital processes. Graphics that we create are digitally printed onto huge backdrops with large format inkjet printers. Lines that we draw in a CAD program are cut into plywood with computer-controlled routers. It's a necessity to be plugged in some sort of way. And when we're talking about 3D workflows, 3D printers really complete that loop. It's really easy to get lost in a CAD drawing. CAD programs allow you to sort of zoom in and out indefinitely, and you can really lose sight of the big picture. And after all that work is done, it's really hard to show that work to somebody else without glossing over the intricacies. 3D forms are really hard to represent on 2D pieces of paper or a 2D computer screen. 3D printers bring digital ideas back into reality where a broader range of collaborators can interact with that idea. The printing press revolutionized the way we distributed the written word. Laser and inkjet printers had a huge impact on graphic design. And 3D printing is going to transform the workflow of anyone who's involved in the design and making of things. 3D printing serves niche markets. So this 3D printed chair here is something that I create for set designers models all the time now, and in essence, it's a niche product. I'm not the only person who needs miniature chairs, but there's definitely not enough demand for somebody to prompt a company to manufacture those in bulk, distribute them, keep an inventory, and make them available in a brick and mortar store or online. And so desktop printers give me the freedom to design and print 1 or 10 copies whenever I want to. I'm making physical, functional objects that perfectly meet my needs in the comfort of my studio apartment. And that's kind of crazy. And you know, some people ask, it's like, well, what if I don't own a 3D printer? These days, that's actually not a problem. There are companies like Shapeways, whose 3D printing factory of the future is right here in New York City. You can upload a design of your file, order a copy, and in about a week, it'll arrive at your doorstep ready to go. And if you wanted to sell it to other people, they'll do that too. So somebody else can order your design, they'll print it on demand, and ship it to customers around the world. You can join forces with thousands of creatives, myself included, who are building small businesses utilizing high-end manufacturing technology with very little cost or knowledge upfront. Welcome to the future of manufacturing. More variety, more customization, more opportunity for entrepreneurial spirit, and more niche problems solved. So 3D printing also promotes new distribution methods. The desktop 3D printing movement was born out of DIY and open source communities. The same ideals that spurred technical innovation led to the open sharing of design files. Now, initially, this dynamic felt really foreign to me. Why would I make my intellectual property and hard work available for free? Didn't really make sense to me. But when I started, I needed some feedback. And so I uploaded a handful of designs to a website called Thingiverse under copyleft Creative Commons licenses, which allow users to freely download and print my designs. Actually, I think I closed my eyes as I uploaded because I was really conflicted about the decision, and it's not really something you can take back. And 3 years later, those designs have been downloaded over 100,000 times. Check out a few photos of places that they've ended up. that purple tea party is one of my favorites. So whether a paid 3D printable marketplace that looks more like Apple's App Store is going to emerge, or sort of this free model of distribution continues to reign, it really begs some questions about the distribution of physical objects. How does that change what we own and how we shop? And as a designer, do I devalue my work when I give it away for free? Or do I enrich this common creative culture and myself by letting my work out into the wild instead? So finally, 3D printing invites collaboration. This current crop of desktop 3D printers are kind of interchangeable. I can design something, send it to you, you can print it out, test it, make some changes, send that file back. We can work on a project together, whether we live across the street or halfway around the world. Now, a great example of this is a carpenter in South Africa who lost his fingers in a shop accident reached out to a prop maker online who had designed some functional, sort of steampunk style puppet fingers. And together they collaborated on a 3D printed prosthetic. And adaptations of that initial design have been printed all over the world, primarily through the effort of an organization called Enable. These citizen inventors continually improve the low-cost 3D printed prosthetics and provide them to free to underserved populations and kids who need them. Projects like Enable really show the power of distributed design and manufacturing, and it's really interesting to see over the next few years where else we're going to see dynamics like this emerge. So 3D printing has the potential for big impact. Changes in the way we work with digital files, more customization and independent designers in the marketplace, new distribution models that change how we buy and share things, and a lot of options for collaboration. Thanks.